You're watching CHRO Television, Cable 6. This is the CHRO Early Report. Here's Kathy Cox.
Good afternoon. I'm Rhonda London. Kathy Cox has the day off. Some brighter news today from the Minister of Finance about the federal deficit. Paul Martin says the total deficit for the fiscal year that just ended could come in as much as $3.5 billion less than he first predicted. Norman Federley reports.
Last month, the jobless figures looked so good they were leaked in advance. Not so in April. Unemployment climbed by nearly half a point as 65,000 people joined the job hunt. There was new work in some places. In Ontario, 15,000 new jobs in April, another 7,000 in Manitoba. Statistics Canada says the sudden surge in unemployment is really a sign of recovery. So does Paul Martin.
Why I don't like to see the unemployment rate increase, I'm certainly glad to see the reason for it, which is Canadians feeling confident enough that there are jobs out there that they want to really get back and participate in the workforce.
Martin also sprung a surprise on these delegates from the Canadian Federation of Labor. This year's federal deficit may be less than the $45 billion forecast in his budget.
The reason for that is that we have created 115,000 jobs in the last three months. Consumer confidence is up, corporate profits are up, and people are beginning to be hired.
And labor union members who booed Preston Manning liked Martin's message. But cutting the deficit and cutting unemployment must go together.
But if this minister and this Gretchen government intends to create jobs, then we'll back them 100%.
It goes hand in hand, as Mr. Martin said. The best way to bring this deficit down, or not the best way, but an excellent way, would be to create jobs.
But the deficit remains a dark cloud in Martin's economic weather forecast. In fact, he says the country's debt is so serious that it threatens our economic sovereignty. Norman Federley in Ottawa.
Canada has offered to help enforce new sanctions imposed on Haiti. Canada's ambassador to Washington, Louise Frechette, says Canada is willing to help ensure the sanctions are complied with by placing monitors along Haiti's border with the Dominican Republic. Broader sanctions aimed at dislodging Haiti's military government were approved today by the UN Security Council. The council is giving Haitian rulers 15 days to resign or face a near-total trade embargo. The Caribbean nation is under an arms and fuel embargo. A domestic dispute is being considered the cause of a murder-suicide overnight in the Ottawa Valley town of Papineauville, Quebec. An armed man rushed a Papineauville home about 1 o'clock this morning, brandishing a hunting rifle. Police say he shot and killed two people and wounded a third before taking his own life. The gunman shot and killed his former mate's new boyfriend and her mother. Her father was badly wounded but managed to crawl out of the house and call police. The father is in hospital in critical condition. The woman told police her 7-year relationship with the gunman had ended about a month ago. Police refused to release names in the case.
More housing, better policing, and a user-friendly transit system. A Centertown group wants to see some changes in its community. I'm Ali Arrhenio, and I'll have that story later in the Early Report.
I'm David Battistelli. In sports, some rookie soccer players are making their mark at McKenzie High School in Deep River. That story coming up later on the Early Report.
We're at the beautiful Granary Restaurant in Eganville, and this is one of my biggest fans, Gabrielle. That's one of her biggest fans. And the Mozart Festival is wrapping up tomorrow night. We're going to have details on that and the forecast. Good-looking weekend. We'll have that good news near 6 o'clock.
And when we come back, let's talk Ontario budget with the man who created the document, Finance Minister Floyd Loughran, right after this. No new taxes. That's one thing Ontarians can applaud the new provincial budget for. It's also supposed to create jobs through research and development incentives, reductions in payroll taxes, and making small business loans more accessible. But there's been a lot of grumbling over what was supposed to be a good news budget from economists, union leaders, and anti-poverty groups. With more on the budget, I'm joined by Ontario Finance Minister Floyd Loughran. Mr. Lagren, I know that you've been taking a lot of flack over the projected deficit, which is forecasted to be $8.5 billion this year. Now, your government has missed its deficit projections in all three previous budgets, although you were close last year. Will it be different this time?
Well, could I emphasize just how close we were last year? We predicted a deficit of $9.2 billion, and we ended up with $9.4 billion. That's about 0.2% on a $50 billion budget. So we were very, very close last year. We think that with the economic recovery occurring, that we can achieve the 8.5 for this coming year. So, because our numbers were quite cautious, and we think that we can achieve them.
Well, some have accused you of creative accounting and even cooking the books to arrive at that $8.5 billion figure, and that the deficit will likely be more in the area of $10 billion. What do you say to criticisms like that?
Well, I mean, some parts of it I don't understand, because the business community, the private sector, has amortized its debt on major investments forever. And when we do it, we're accused of doing something strange. There's nothing unusual about amortizing large capital investment projects. I mean, it's like buying a house and paying off your mortgage. I think there's a big difference between paying off your mortgage over 20 years or 30 years and going into debt to buy your groceries every week. And it's the operating part, the groceries every week, if you will, that we've got to get that deficit eliminated, and that's what we've committed to do by 1998.
Even so, the projected deficit of $8.5 billion is off the mark from what you projected it would be this year, which was supposed to be $6.8 billion. Which brings us to a good point. Just how subjective are these kinds of financial forecasts?
In the last 4 years, the projections by the private sector, by all governments, have missed the mark, because the recession has been much, much more serious than anybody thought it would be. So I'm not surprised that everybody has missed the projections. I mean, I looked at the federal government. They predicted a deficit for the year of about $32 billion. It ends up being $45. I mean, you talk about missing your targets. That's doing it in grand style. We think, though, that given the recovery now, given the expenditure controls that we put in place, that we can achieve those deficit numbers and without raising any taxes.
Well, let's talk about job creation. Now, you're hoping to create something in the area of 350,000 jobs over the next 3 years.
Right.
Where will all those jobs come from?
Mostly from the private sector. We do what we can on the capital side. We spend more on capital, which are private sector jobs, I remind you, when highways are built or when buildings, schools or hospitals or whatever. It's the private sector that does the building and the public sector that pays for it. So most of the jobs are going to come through the recovery, and that'll be through the private sector. We, as a province, can do some, but we can't do it all. The tax holiday, if you will, on new hirees from the employer's health tax this year is an indication to employers that, look, we want you out there hiring new workers now. And we think that'll create about 12,000 new jobs this year. And nobody has challenged us on those numbers. I think it's a fairly safe number.
Finance Minister Floyd Lagren, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
And debate on the budget continues across Ontario. Here in Ottawa and the Valley, there are mixed opinions. Renfrew North MPP Sean Conway says the government must give the private sector more freedom to do business and create jobs. But Ottawa Centre MPP and Housing Minister Evelyn Gigantis says this budget is an indication our economy has turned the corner.
I think we're looking at a turning point in the economy. Private investment is looking good, and business confidence is up. Ontario looks like it's really going to build from here on in, and that's good news for everyone.
We are going to have to recognize that the private sector is going to be the engine of recovery and economic growth. And whether it's workers' compensation, hydro, regulation, at a whole series of levels, we in government, local, provincial, and national, are simply going to have to do more and be better at reducing government-imposed costs.
When we come back, the final vote count is finally in. Nelson Mandela, the huge winner.
Closed captioning for today's program provided by Arnfryer Guardian Drugs.
South Africa's election results are official. Nelson Mandela's African National Congress captured nearly a third of all votes in the country. The nearly two-thirds part of the equation will prove very important because the ANC can't write a new constitution by itself, which was one of the party's goals.
The Independent Electoral Commission officially sanctioned South Africa's first multiracial poll.
We have concluded that we can certify each of the 10 elections concerned to have been substantially free and fair.
The ANC has won 62% of the vote, and President-elect Nelson Mandela has lost no time in holding talks without going President de Klerk to set up the new National Unity Government. After 3 hours, the two had worked out the number of cabinet places for the top three parties. Mr. de Klerk then paid tribute to the new first deputy president.
Likewise, I would like to extend my congratulations to my new colleague, Mr. Thabo Mbeki, who will also be, as I will be, executive deputy president in the Government of National Unity.
Mr. de Klerk's own efforts to break apartheid were also given recognition.
The outgoing state president, Mr. F.W. de Klerk, was after all the first National Party leader who has ever shown the courage and conviction to face the realities of our country.
The new confidence in South Africa was reflected in the financial markets, as fears that the ANC would reach a two-thirds majority and rewrite the constitution receded.
Finally, the tunnel is open for business. The rail tunnel, which links Britain and France underneath the English Channel, was opened this morning by Queen Elizabeth and French President François Mitterrand. It'll be a few months before rail service actually begins, but no expense was spared on the pomp and ceremony.
Queen Elizabeth arrives to inaugurate a new London terminal for trains that will soon carry passengers to Paris in under 3 hours, crossing under the English Channel. But it's more than that. This day of inaugural ceremonies signals the end of Britain's proud identity as an island nation. Prime ministers past and present join the Queen for the first official trip. Margaret Thatcher started the project. It took 7 years to dig the tunnel and cost $13 billion. On the French side, Elizabeth met President Mitterrand at the Coquel station near Calais, which Britain once ruled. The two then returned to England. The French have wanted a tunnel for more than a century. The British, remembering the Hundred Years' War and Napoleon, resisted for years. But both leaders acknowledged the importance of cooperation in the modern world as Europe's single market moves towards greater unity. The tunnel is officially open, but won't be operational for several months. The warmth between the two heads of state swept aside centuries of history of suspicion, bitterness, and war. And now this link is established, Britain is, for the first time, truly European. Adam Rayfield, CBS News, at the Channel Tunnel.
John Bobbitt has been thrown into jail in Las Vegas for allegedly assaulting a woman police describe as his fiancée. Police say officers picked up Bobbitt early this morning after getting a domestic violence complaint. They say no formal charges have been filed so far. The woman involved has not been identified. Bobbitt, of course, gained world attention last year when his wife Lorena cut off his penis, claiming abuse. She was acquitted by reason of insanity in connection with the case. The Bobbitt divorce is pending. When we return, we'll show you concrete proof that aerobics are not only for the young. Then David Battistelli will step in with a first look at sports news. First, though, the closing market quotations. It's generally believed that aerobics classes are for the young and the strong. There is, however, one definite exception to this rule. She's 87. She doesn't understand why people think she's so exceptional. And she just wants a healthy body.
Alrighty, look, set her shoulders now.
If the old adage, you're as young as you feel, is true, then Kate Abel has lost a few decades on her way to the gym.
She's wonderful. She's always happy. She acts like a 20-year-old.
But this model of fitness was 20 years old 67 years ago. She turned 87 in January.
I don't feel my age. I don't know why people talk about numbers.
She marches, stretches, swings, and kicks her way through aerobics at the Lady Fitness Health Club 4 to 5 days a week.
There's nothing to it. There's really nothing to it. No effort.
And no, one class just isn't enough.
I really feel as though I didn't get the proper workout if I only take one class. So I usually take one right after the other. It's about a little less than 2 hours.
Because of her perfect attendance and great attitude, she's the club's exerciser of the month. Kate just can't understand what all the fuss is about.
To me, this is just something that everybody should be able to do. It's not a matter of age. It's a matter of commitment and determination.
Kate's also determined to keep learning. Besides aerobics and her daily half-mile walk to the gym, this retired English teacher is studying Hebrew. French is next. You see, Kate says life has treated her well all these years because she's got the concept of aging all figured out.
You know that poem about growing old? I'll wear purple when I'm old. Well, I'm going to wear purple while I'm young. I don't intend to grow the other way.
Sandra Moss for CBS News.
Gee, what an inspiration. I'm thinking of going back to aerobics class.
87, I don't know how she does it. Unbelievable.
So let me guess, what's coming up in sports? Hockey, and more hockey?
Yes, and it's been an unbelievable playoff so far. The Toronto Maple Leafs will try not to become shark bait tonight in Game 3 of the Western Conference semifinal. The Leafs and the Sharks are tied at one game apiece. Meanwhile, the Vancouver Canucks can take a stranglehold on their series with the Stars. Vancouver leads Dallas 2-0, with the next three games being played at the Pacific Coliseum. Vancouver's Pavel Bure may not dress tonight. The NHL is considering a one-game suspension over an elbowing incident with Stars tough guy Shane Chrla. A lot of night hawks will be wide awake and armchair to the spectate the Leaf-Shark game tonight. That includes a fan club from Pembroke's Fellows High School. These students will be cheering on one of their own, a key forward with Toronto. Nancy Bell has the story.
Toronto fans at Maple Leaf Gardens and from afar breathed a sigh of relief Wednesday night after the Maple Leafs, even the playoff series with the San Jose Sharks, had won. Some 76 diehard supporters from Fellows High School in Pembroke have been rooting on Pat Burns' club all year long. They're proud to be attending the same school number 32 Mike Eastwood graduated from in 87. One student is even blood related to Dave Andrechuk.
He doesn't even know yet, so as soon as I get time, I'm thinking about I'm joining the club so I can write to him and tell him.
Every time the Leafs suit up for a game, so do the Fellows fan club members. And they're not all students.
I don't get called in too often, but when I do, I'd like to take advantage of a big win to come in and harass some of the Montreal Canadian teachers. And this was a great opportunity today. I'm thankful for the vice principal for calling me in because we're on a roll and Montreal is out.
One of the executives can see the Blue and Whites going all the way to the Stanley Cup Finals.
They can go to the finals. I don't know if they can be three inches, but they can go to the finals.
This grade niner, who's watched the Leafs on the tube since she was five, disagrees.
It will go 7 games and Toronto will win 6-5.
Michelle is secure in her answer. Her lucky charm hasn't let her down yet.
I have a blanket, and I always have to be with that blanket when the Leafs play because it's bad luck. I will not sleep without that blanket, or I have a really bad night's sleep.
And for the Maple Leafs, the greatest dream they're hoping for is not a nightmare in San Jose. I'm Nancy Bell for CHRO Sports.
Canada has a settled score with Sweden tomorrow. Team Canada takes on the Swedes at the World Hockey Championships in Italy. With a win, Canada will avenge their Olympic loss to Sweden and advance to Sunday's gold medal game. And coming up later, the Expos and the Braves have a big game of their own and a report on girls' soccer in Pembroke. And that's it in sports.
All right, Dave. And when we come back, we'll send you back to Eganville right after the break, where Bob Cowan is standing by with the full weather picture.
Welcome back to Early Report. We're inside the beautiful Greenery Restaurant in Eganville, and this is quite a landmark. Right behind me is, I should actually introduce Gabrielle first from the Greenery. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you, Bob.
What a beautiful mural. Who painted that?
This painted a gentleman from England who lives in Toronto right now. And he's a kind of a shy man. He lives on a boat and has a little studio down there.
In the boat?
No, in Toronto.
Oh, okay. That would be a big boat. Yeah. That's just gorgeous. Was it a donation?
No, we paid for that.
Big bucks?
Yes, big bucks.
Okay, what's that retail value, Gabrielle?
$8,000.
$8,000? Well, no, it's worth it. That's pretty incredible. That's just amazing. You can see it here in the flesh or in the canvas by dropping by the Greenery Restaurant. Good reason to drop by this week. Of course, all week long, the Mozart Festival has been going, and I guess it wraps up this weekend with some pretty big events.
Yes, it's been on for the last week, Bob, and it has been a big success. A lot of things going on. Tonight we have harpsichord music and voices from the Renaissance times.
Well, it's like going back in time. That's just, how much was that dress, retail value?
I'm not telling you.
Okay. More than $8,000, I'll tell you. Anyways, we'll find out more about what's happening for the rest of the weekend here at the Greenery and weather-wise as well. First up, Cross Canada map as we see how things look coast to coast today. Well, it was beautiful in the prairie provinces. They're getting summer early as well. Vancouver had sunshine, 19 degrees. And throughout the prairies, the temperature is as high as 20 degrees for Calgary and Edmonton. Nice, sunny, and hot as well. Montreal was wet today, 13 degrees, and actually is wet throughout much of the east coast, including Fredericton, with a 9-degree daytime high. Let's look at Ontario. Sunshine in Thunder Bay, but it was wet in the Sioux and Sudbury, 7 and 8 degrees. Southern Ontario, partly sunny skies for Windsor, 14 degrees. St. Catharines cloudy, and Toronto cloud cover with a 13 degree daytime high. Okay, let's zip along to the valley. Well, it's a real mix today. Wet this morning, then we had clearing, and it looked like it was going to turn out okay. Now it looks like thunderstorms are looming overhead. Temperature-wise, it was kind of cool in Ottawa, no higher than 12 degrees, but Pembroke was the hot spot. They got as high as 16 degrees today. Here's the overall stats. The winds were light, 9 kilometers per hour out of the west. The barometer at 100.6, humidity at 80%. Barometer at 100.6, steady. I think I just said that, but it's worth repeating. Clear skies tonight, or clearing skies, low of around 3, winds westerly 15 clicks, and 30% chance of precipitation. Mind you, we could get some... it could be imminent, but clearing overnight. And tomorrow, sunshine, high of 16, winds light, 20% probability of precipitation. So Saturday is a great-looking day, and actually Sunday's a good-looking day as well. So good news in the three-day forecast. We'll have that in about 10 minutes from the Greenery Restaurant and more about the Mozart Festival. Gabriel's going to fill us in.
And coming up in our next half hour, U.S. President Clinton finds himself in a legal battle over allegations of sexual abuse. A Liberal member of Parliament wants sex offenders to be subject to blood tests. And also coming up, Quebec Provincial Police say a romance gone wrong may have led to a murder-suicide.
This is the CHRO Early Report. Here's Kathy Cox.
Good evening, I'm Rhonda London. Kathy Cox has the day off. The national unemployment rate jumped last month because a lot more people were looking for work without success. Statistics Canada says the 11% fixing, up from 10.6, reflects a rapid rise in the number of adults entering the workforce. And there was also some encouraging news today from the Minister of Finance on how the deficit is shaping up for the fiscal year just passed. CTV's Dave Wren reports.
The unemployment rate is up. It's 11% nationally for April. Job growth essentially stalled in all provinces except Ontario and Manitoba. Statistics Canada reports the rate would have dropped marginally except for an increase of 65,000 people who re-entered the job market last month. Finance Minister Paul Martin interprets that as a positive sign, even though those people couldn't find work.
Why I don't like to see the unemployment rate increase, I'm certainly glad to see the reason for it, which is Canadians feeling confident enough that there are jobs out there that they want to really get back and participate in the workforce.
The construction industry has made the biggest gains, 83,000 new jobs in the past 3 months. Gains in manufacturing are holding steady, an estimated 74,000 new jobs. Even the deficit is dropping. The finance minister says it will fall below $44 billion, much less than his budget projection of $45.7 billion.
The reason for that is that we have created 115,000 jobs in the last three months. Consumer confidence is up, corporate profits are up, and people are beginning to be hired.
Despite the finance minister's optimism, he was reminded by the head of the Canadian Federation of Labor that 1.5 million Canadians are still out of work.
I don't know of anyone that is unemployed, at least from our membership, that is not ready, willing, and able to take a job if it was available.
No one predicts this sudden surge in unemployment will be the start of an upward trend, but it is unnerving for Finance Minister Paul Martin. After all, his goal is to get more people working, because that means more people will be paying taxes. Dave Wren, CTV News, Ottawa.
More suggestions today on what to do with Ottawa's center town. A coalition of community groups released 20 recommendations, hoping the city of Ottawa picks up the challenge and acts on the report. Al Uranu has the details.
There are at least six studies underway in Ottawa's center town, including the mayor's Redo It Committee. Members of the community planted this tree on city property, directly in front of vacant land owned by Alt Dairies. One suggestion is the lot could be turned into an 11-story residential building with about 40 units. That's one of 20 ideas released by the umbrella group called the Centertown Community Council, made up of church, community, and school associations. Among the other suggestions, waive building permit fees and development charges for new and rehabilitated housing. Enforce existing traffic bylaws, such as speed limits. Have more trash cans on city streets. Tie the salaries of OC Transpo senior management to ridership levels. And pedestrian crossings should be upgraded.
All of which could be carried over the next several months. All may be implemented using existing resources and are consistent with the center town and other chapters of Ottawa's official plan, as well as the region's plan for a network of bicycle lanes.
Many of these suggestions were part of a city plan filed more than 20 years ago, but for whatever reasons, various city councils have decided to ignore them. This community group wants vacant landowners to sell their lots and not turn them into parking lots. In Ottawa, Al Uranu, CHRO News.
A former Arkansas state employee has slapped U.S. President Clinton with a lawsuit on charges of sexual harassment. Paula Corbin Jones accuses then-Governor Clinton of inflicting emotional distress, defamation, and civil rights violations.
The lawsuit filed by a new set of lawyers demands at least $700,000 in damages for depriving Paula Jones of her civil rights, conspiracy, emotional distress, and defamation. Named as defendants, Bill Clinton and Danny Ferguson, a state trooper assigned to then-Governor Clinton. In May 1991, Clinton attended a conference at this Little Rock hotel. Jones, then a state employee, alleges the trooper asked her to go to Clinton's suite, where Clinton made unwanted sexual advances. The suit, in graphic detail, describes Clinton pulling down his pants. After being rebuffed, Clinton allegedly mentioned Jones's boss and said, "You're smart. Let's keep this between ourselves." Paula Jones was not at the courthouse, but her lawyer made a statement on her behalf.
This case is not about money. This case is about character and integrity. This case is about the powerful taking advantage of the weak. This case is about my name and my reputation in the eyes of my family, my young son, and my community. This case is about justice.
Paula Jones's credibility is under examination. Even her sister now says Jones told her she was thrilled about Clinton's sexual advances and also told her whichever way it went, it smelt money. Robert Bennett, President Clinton's private lawyer, immediately responded, calling the lawsuit politically motivated tabloid trash.
We absolutely deny, without any question, that this incident occurred. This president did not engage in any inappropriate or sexual conduct with this woman.
At the White House, President Clinton was asked about the lawsuit.
Bob Bennett spoke for me, and I'm going back to work. I'm not going to dignify this by commenting on it.
It's expected Clinton's lawyer will ask the lawsuit be thrown out because of a Supreme Court case that prohibits some lawsuits against sitting presidents. Kent Gerald for CBS News, Little Rock.
A nasty breakup is being labeled the cause of a murder-suicide today in Papineauville, Quebec. A man armed with a hunting rifle burst into a home in the valley town around 1 o'clock this morning, killing three and wounding another before taking his own life. James Duffy reports.
Tragic results of a bitter breakup. Early this morning, police removed the bodies of three people from this home in the tiny town of Pappyville.
It's very shocking. Because in a town like this, you just don't expect something like this to happen.
Yeah, that's true.
Around 1 a.m., police say 47-year-old Michel Audet of Gatineau broke into the front window of the house and started shooting. He wounded his ex-girlfriend's father, Rosario Carrière, then killed her mother, Françoise Carrière, and her new boyfriend, Philippe Gauthier. He then turned the gun on himself.
That's the whole boyfriend, and they left him 1 month ago.
They broke up 1 month ago?
Yeah, they broke up 1 month ago. And maybe that's the reason.
The ex-girlfriend, Lucy Carrière, saved herself by hiding under a bed. Her injured father staggered next door to the house of Rodolphe Séguin. I was shocked, he says. He was bleeding badly. I can't believe this would happen here. On the surface, police say the motive is obvious. Anger over the breakup and jealousy over his ex-girlfriend's new relationship. But they may never know what turned those feelings into such a brutal act. James Duffy in Papineauville, Quebec.
I'm Dr. Dean Adel. Coming up, how a lawnmower can be a lethal weapon.
And when we come back, a Liberal MP wants to champion the cause of rape victims. An Aylmer dog owner may have set a precedent in Quebec over the care and safety of pets. Jean Delacroix has successfully sued an Aylmer grooming salon after his dog died following a session earlier this year. The pet, a lab shepherd mix called Mandy, died of cardiac arrest after being groomed by the Salon de Tante d'Aylmer. The written judgment stated the salon had the responsibility to treat the dog. Delacroix says he launched the action mainly to show that businesses like grooming salons have a responsibility for the animals under their care. A convicted child molester has been sentenced to 6 months in jail for sexually assaulting two patients at the Royal Ottawa Hospital. Lauren Francois was undergoing a psychiatric assessment at the hospital when the assaults took place. A former patient testified that Francois grabbed his crotch while the two were sitting in a TV lounge. The court heard Francois later exposed himself in the washroom. Francois, a mildly retarded Prescott man, was brought from prison to the hospital in 1991 for a court-ordered assessment. He is serving 6 years for sex crimes against children, including the rape of a teenage girl and the sexual assault of two teenage boys. Derek Lee, the Liberal Member of Parliament for Scarborough Rouge River, has introduced a private member's bill that would give rape victims the right to request court-ordered blood tests. One of the leading advocates of this movement is a 46-year-old grandmother from Quebec who was raped. Bill Rogers reports.
50,000 people supporting Liberal Derek Lee's private member's bill have signed a petition that will be presented to Parliament. Among them, Margot Blackburn, a grandmother from Dunham, Quebec. She was raped in 1992 by a federal inmate on day parole. There is no legal way to order her assailant to be tested for infectious disease. Blackburn met this morning with Justice Minister Alan Rock.
Well, Mr. Rock told us that he would see the question, study it.
And Rock promises an answer by September. However, defense lawyers are already suggesting such blood tests would violate the Charter of Rights of an accused rapist. Derek Lee bristles at that suggestion.
All right, I don't want to talk to lawyers about this anymore. I want to talk to victims. I want the victims to have their say heard by parliamentarians. That's the place where the laws are made, not in defense lawyers' offices. Secondly, one day in this country, it will be a criminal offense to knowingly infect another with a sexually transmitted disease.
Canadian Police Association Vice President Scott Newark says blood tests are already being taken in drunk driving cases.
And if the Supreme Court of Canada wants to say you can't do this, let the Supreme Court of Canada say this. I'm completely confident that this is valid legislation.
This is the latest private member's bill on law and order to be presented by a Liberal MP.
But Derek Lee insists it does not suggest liberals are getting frustrated with their own government's slow pace on these issues. Bill Rogers, CFTO News, Ottawa.
A 16-year-old high school student faces six charges after a vice principal at Sir Guy Carleton School was threatened with a knife. Police say it all began after one student assaulted another. The student was brought into the office to have the matter dealt with. Then the accused threw a chair across the room, ran into the cafeteria, and stole a knife. He then began slashing lockers, door frames, and threatened the vice principal and a teacher. He ran out of the school but was arrested by police a short distance away. Among the charges, threats to kill, assault with a weapon, and assault. Well, Bob Cowan is standing by with details on the weekend weather forecast. Then David will have another look at the day in sports. We're back in 60 seconds. Well, Dave, it's supposed to be a good weekend.
I hope so. Try to get a golf game in.
Well, for the extended forecast and all the details, we go once again to Bob Cowan in Eganville. Bob?
Thank you, Rhonda. Back at the Granary Restaurant in Eganville, and there's that $8,000 mural, and there's Mozart. And actually, it wasn't a guy in Toronto. It's not $8,000, but actually, you hand out crayons to the kids while they're waiting for their food, and this is the accumulation of years of work. No, it's that's just an incredible piece of art, and it's a beautiful spot here. And, Gabriel, the Mozart Festival actually wraps up tomorrow night, and what's on tap?
Tonight we have Renaissance music, and tomorrow night we have somebody who is not too keen on classical music. We have Broadway,
showstoppers.
Broadway and cabaret, from Kurt Weill to the Sound of Music. Something for everybody.
Oh, yeah, and the Sound of Music, well, that fits in because we got a little slice of Austria right here. You can feel it. Just thanks for that. This is the most expensive wardrobe in Early Report yet. That's just incredible. You look just great. And
thank you.
It's just incredible here. The Mozart Festival, if you haven't been to the Granary, check it out this weekend. It's the perfect opportunity. And weather-wise, it's a good weekend for whatever you have planned. We got not so hot today with the thunderstorm activity we've had looming overhead in the valley, but it is going to clear up. So good-looking weekend on the way. First up, let's take a look at that valley map overnight tonight. We're going to see... After we get this thunderstorms passing overhead, there is going to be clearing overnight. Temperature-wise, we'll get as low as 3 degrees for the upper reaches of the valley, about 5 degrees for Ottawa Hull and for Pembroke, Petawawa as well. Here's the stats. The wind's westerly, 15 kilometers per hour, so they're picking up a little bit. The probability of precipitation, 30%, but that will diminish. Tomorrow, Saturday, sunshine, the high at 16, winds light. 20% chance of precipitation, as I mentioned, and so it's a good-looking day, and so is Sunday as we move along to the three-day sunshine, high of 16, that's seasonal. Back to work Monday, we'll get some sunshine, but there is a 40% chance of seeing some showers, and clear skies for Tuesday, sunshine, high of 18. Boy, May has just been a great month thus far, and we'll just keep the fingers crossed. Good-looking weekend, enjoy it, and come visit us at the Greenery. Brian? No, it's Dave. Dave Battistelli, sports guy tonight.
Actually, sports person to you, Bob. A big weekend for the Expos. Montreal is in Atlanta to take on the Braves. The Expos are just half a game back in the National East. Pedro Martinez gets the start for Montreal. Meanwhile, the Toronto Blue Jays will try to snap a two-game losing streak. The Brewers visit the Sky Dome this evening. The New York Knicks and the Houston Rockets can wrap up their NBA series with wins tonight. The Knicks play in New Jersey while the Rockets are at Portland to play the Trailblazers. A light drizzle at Churchill Downs this afternoon. Forecasters say there is a good possibility of a sloppy track for tomorrow's Kentucky Derby. The early favorites are Bronco and Holy Bull. With a 4-0 record this season, McKenzie High School's senior girls soccer team is confident about going all the way to the Renfrew County Final. They're all a little surprised, though, at their success, as half of the team is in their rookie season. Nancy Bell has the story from Deep River.
Amy on the right and Julie Ward on the left. Okay? So that's our starting line.
A starting lineup that sure knows how to win soccer games. McKenzie's team, half vets and half rookies, has the endurance to outrun the other teams. It really helps having cross-country runners and skiers on the field with strong leadership skills.
I just try and encourage the girls as much as possible and keep the play positive and help the new girls out as much as I can.
She has leadership ability with these kids to compliment them every time they do something well, and also to let them know on the field when things aren't going quite so well, and she does it in a really sportsmanlike and a leadership way that we're really proud of.
Kinghorn, the school soccer coach for the past 3 years, has brought her gals this far with a new strategy.
We try to look at what's happened in the last game and where our weaknesses are. We're really working on using our halfbacks this year. We tended to have the three lines playing almost separately, and this year we're trying to work our halfbacks the hardest in the game. We want them to go up with the forward so that we've got stronger support and to get back with the defense. So we've worked a lot on our triangles, and we've worked a lot on our shots.
In front of the net and in front of the camera. In Deep River, I'm Nancy Bell for CHRO Sports.
The CFL has several new franchises and a couple of new owners of old franchises. In his sports comment tonight, Breen Murray says stability may have arrived in the CFL.
Got to read from the newspaper today. TSN buys the Argos. Yes, sir. Here's the quote I like. They have a credibility, a sports and marketing background, a certain profile, and staying power. End of quote I like. Staying power. If there's anything in the world of football the Argonauts need, the entire CFL needs, as a matter of fact, is staying power. Mind you, the league has staying, but with little power over the last 100 years or so, and most of us wondered how in the world they ever stumbled from 1 year to the next. So my comment on the sale of the Argonauts to TSN or Labatt's or JLL Limited is a fine idea. The Argos, it seems, have had as many owners as the Rough Riders in the last dozen years or so. So whoever walks in the door with staying power is to welcome with open arms, even if we have to watch Argo highlights as the lead item every night on TSN.
And Rhonda, Vancouver Canuck fans can relax because Pavel Bure was slapped with a $500 fine for his elbowing incident of tough guy Shane Chirla. And there's no suspension, so he will play tonight and everything's great.
All right, yes. Thanks, yeah. Dave. And stay with us. Medical news is still to come when the early report continues. Scientists have identified a genetic defect that raises the risk of potentially fatal blood clots about 7 times. The defect appears in at least half the cases of the inherited tendency and 20% of all such cases of clotting. Every year, about 200,000 North Americans form clots in their legs that can migrate to the heart or lung and kill. About a quarter have an inherited tendency toward this problem, which is called venous thrombosis. Normally, when Philip Garnham volunteers at the Red Cross, he's sitting behind a desk. Today, though, he is out pounding the pavement for victims of the humanitarian disaster in Rwanda. Garnham wants to raise $10,000 on his run to Kingston. He left Parliament Hill at the noon hour, and Tracy Shoupley was there.
So we're all set to go, and this is 2 days.
Philip Garnham has been a volunteer with the Red Cross for 17 years. Today, with his local MP Peter Milliken at his side, the 26-year-old Kingston man left Ottawa on a 162-kilometer trek home. He is running in recognition of World Red Cross Day Sunday.
This year, all around the world, the theme for the run is Dignity for All. And what we're doing is trying to raise funds and awareness for victims of war all around the world. There are over 100 conflicts in the world right now. Never in the world have we been closer to peace, yet never has the violence been so bad.
Garnham says just last week, 13 Red Cross workers were killed in Rwanda. He plans to reach Smith Falls tonight and arrive in Kingston early Sunday evening. For those who want to help Garnham's run, you can contact the Ottawa-Carleton branch of the Red Cross. From the Carleton School of Journalism, I'm Tracy Shoupley for CHRO News.
It's being hailed as a celebration of healthy living. The Renfrew County and District Health Unit is holding a Women's Health Festival this weekend. It gets underway tomorrow morning at 10 and runs until 4 in the afternoon. The event is being held at Algonquin College in Pembroke and admission is free. There will be a wide range of exhibits from cooking to line dancing and a host of attractions focusing on women's health issues. Summer is almost here and many people are headed out to their gardens. But as Dr. Dina Dell reports today in the Village Pharmacy Medical Report, there is a new safety warning about something most of us take for granted.
The first time killer bees attacked anybody in the United States, a lawnmower ran into their nest. The gardener paid the price with multiple stings.
My head, my right hand, my fingers.
This isn't likely to happen to you, but if you use a lawnmower, beware of some startling new statistics. According to the Consumer Product Safety Commission, 60,000 people a year are injured by mowers, one-sixth of which result in amputations or serious fractures.
Most of us take mowing our lawn for granted. We even teach our kids how to do it, let them earn a few extra bucks. But if you look at even this old push mower, you can see there are some sharp blades down here that could do a lot of damage. Well, just think how much more dangerous a power mower can be. Well, this report says anyone using a mower should think of them as a potentially lethal weapon.
In fact, the report says mowers can be deadly. 75 people died last year from lawnmower injuries. Most injuries involve people under the age of 16 or over the age of 55. And while we all talk about health care costs, think about this one. We spend almost $500 million each year just treating lawnmower injuries, most of which are preventable. Of course, this could solve the problem. It's a new solar-powered robotic lawnmower. Since it's totally automatic, it should increase safety, not to mention increasing your lazy days of leisure. I'm Dr. Dean Adell.
Now, the Johnson & Mackey Insurance headlines.
Here are the hour's top stories. Finance Minister Paul Martin says the federal deficit for the last fiscal year may be as low as $44 billion. Martin had predicted the deficit would be as high as $45.7 billion. Statistics Canada announced today the April unemployment rate was 11% even, up from the March fixing of 10.6. The government agency says the rate went up because of an influx of people re-entering the labor market. And the government has fired the chairman of the National Parole Board, but Michael Dagenet remains a member of the board. Dagenet played a part in the release of five prisoners who went on to murder seven victims. And that's our time on the Early Report. Our next news is at 11 tonight. That's the CTV News with Lloyd Robertson. Immediately following, join David Battistelli for details on all the NHL playoff action. That's coming up on Sports Late Night at 11:30, along with other sports news of the day. And we leave you tonight with some scenes of spring. Have a good night and a great weekend.
Okay, test it.
Mommy,
test it.
Yes.